you now from his tour bus. Billy, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me on the show.
And congratulations. What was that like to win your first Grammy?
It's unreal, man. I've been on the road for like the past 10 years, you know, playing, man, almost 200 gigs a year, and it's made me really reflect on everything we've been through the last few years.
Tell me about this journey for you, the last 28 years of your life, led up to this moment. Like, how did you get here? Was music in your family growing up?
Yeah, it absolutely was. My dad is a wonderful guitar player and singer, and plays a lot of bluegrass music, but he can't play anything, you know, rock and roll and stuff like that. But it was always bluegrass too, you know. I think maybe through his grandfather or father, somebody turned him on to Bill Monroe, and by the time I was 4 years old, I had a guitar and he taught me some chords, and my dad would play all the fancy licks and I just played rhythm.
Did you have an aha moment, like, oh yeah, like I'm good, or I just figured this thing out?
I think that moment really happened when I was about 6 years old. I'm gonna paint you a portrait in words here. Little trailer, little bedroom in the back. Me and my dad are sitting there in our underwear playing bluegrass music, and he's trying to teach me chords and stuff, and I'm 6 years old. We're playing Beaumont Rag, which is this old fiddle tune, and I always messed up the chords. I was frustrated, and I just go, stop. Just, Dad, just stop. And I'm like, why don't you just play it and just let me listen? And so he did. He played the melody, and instead of holding the chord and counting to four and then going to the next chord and counting to four, so instead of thinking about it like that, I listened to what his guitar was saying. It was like, you know, after that, I was like, okay, let me try it again, now that I have really got the melody in my head. And I friggin' nailed it. And he was so proud. He just leaned over and like squeezed my little hand. And that moment has pushed me to this day. I mean, I still think about that. And like the other day when we won the Grammy, who did I call? I called my dad, you know, right away. Look, Dad, you taught me well.
And you know, the first time I heard of you, I saw your name, Billy Strings, and I was like, Billy Strings, that can't be his real name, that's too perfect. Where'd that name come from?
Well, it came from my Aunt Mondi, she's not really my aunt, she's just one of my mom's best friends. You know, she's the one that gave me that nickname when I was like, just a little kid. She just said it one time, look at little Billy Strings over there trying to play with all the big dogs. And later on when I was a teenager, I went to visit her when she was on her deathbed, and somebody told her we were there, and she got out of bed. She come out to the garage, and it wasn't long before the guitars got busted out, you know, because Mondi always wanted to hear us play. Man, it was just this crazy thing. I mean, she hadn't drank in 4 or 5 years, and she's been sick, and she's just been laying in bed. And, you know, we start playing music, and she gets up and starts dancing, and she grabs the joint and starts hitting it, and she cracks a beer. And she's like, I haven't drank in 4 years, you know? And it was just amazing. We sat there and just played all night, man. Yeah. And she died not long after that. And that was around the same time that in Traverse City, I was just beginning to like play open mic nights and stuff. And after she died, when I went up to the chalkboard to write my name up there, I wrote Billy Strings, you know, in her honor.
Well, Billy, I think Mondi knew what she was doing with that name. I think she got it pretty spot on. Why don't we listen to some of your music? Because we read that you actually spent a lot of time in heavy metal bands as a teenager, and I think we can kind of hear that at the end of your song Home on the album. Let's listen.
But I also, you know, by the time I was 10 or 11, my dad got me an electric guitar. And that's when I started learning about Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath, Johnny Winter, Yes, you know, Pink Floyd. And that made a big impact, especially Johnny Winter's guitar playing, you know, and the psychedelia of Pink Floyd was really interesting. You know, like as a young kid with a very imaginative mind, listening to the album The Dark Side of the Moon was like watching a movie.
Well, it's not all genre mixing here, right? Let's listen to another song called Hollow Heart, in which you say you were trying to write an old bluegrass song.
Like you said, where there's different genres and there's, you know, weird sounds and effects, but I like to also always have some pure bluegrass in there, almost like a palate cleanser, I guess.
Yeah, you know, to my ear, Home is actually filled with other songs that are quite dark. For example, there's this one, it's called Enough to Live.
Enough to kill you, enough to put you down.
Two friends of yours, I understand, died as a result of taking heroin laced with fentanyl, and I'm going to ask you about that in just a minute if you don't mind. But first, there's also this track called Guitar Piece. It's instrumental, and it also has a somber feel to it.
I pretty much got high and turned on the mics and tried to come up with something on the spot. I was watching this George Harrison documentary where there was a lot of him and like Ravi Shankar doing this kind of stream of consciousness playing, you know. And I wanted to do something like that. So I just smoked a bunch of weed and tried to put something out.
Does that help you in the creative process? Because I know some artists are kind of conflicted about that.
Yeah, I think so. As soon as I would smoke a little bit, I'd be like, man, where's my guitar? You know, and I'd just go find it and just go play.
Do you think you can do it as well without the drugs?
Yeah, I don't know if it just helps me get into the mood of the song or the emotion or what, you know. I mean, there's been several times in the last few years where I did stop smoking, and I don't think it affected my music at all.
Yeah, no judgment for me. I'm just curious.
Of course.
But I do want to ask you about something else related to drugs, and this is serious. I said before that some of your friends had died of an overdose, and I just want to see if you'd be willing to talk about that for a moment. Tell me how they inspired your music.
Well, yeah, that song, Enough to Leave, I wrote that after two of my friends died of a heroin overdose within probably a week of each other. One friend was this girl who I went to elementary school with, and my other buddy was kind of responsible for almost getting me into the scene that I'm in now. Man, I was just crushed, you know? So I just sat down and wrote that song and kind of wanted to do something for him, and that's kind of all I know how to do.
I give you diamonds, I give you rings and pearls.
Before I let you go, you're speaking to us from your tour bus. I mean, you're about to perform in Florida. What's that like? I mean, because this whole year for artists has been very complicated and really difficult, being locked up. Are you back on the road?
I'm back on the road in a sense. We're playing one in Florida where there's, you know, socially distanced sort of pods. And then when we go to New Orleans and play, like, there's nobody there. You know, they're just live streaming shows. So, like, you know, we're on tour, but we're still playing for the internet. We are doing some of those socially distanced events, and it's going to be incredible. I can't wait to play for people again. That's what I do. I know it's a release for a lot of those folks, as it is for me. Just getting able to get together with my band and play music is such a blessing.
Well, why don't we go out listening to some more from your Grammy Award-winning bluegrass album, Home, Billy Strings, thank you so much. It was a real pleasure to speak with you, and congratulations again.
Thank you so much for having me, and hopefully I'll see you out there somewhere.
Michigan Radio, Michigan's NPR news leader. Good afternoon. I'm Rebecca Kruth. Still to come, Myanmar's military is throttling the internet to prevent images of their February 1st coup and crackdown from reaching the world. It's not working, even as worries about an even more brutal crackdown grow. More on that coming up in 15 minutes. A year ago on Stateside, we spoke with a teacher who was optimistic the pandemic would force education systems to rethink and fix what's broken in public schools. Now?
I feel less optimistic compared to the last time we talked, to be completely honest. They're literally trying to force us into the model we had before COVID.
The changes and stagnancy of K-12 education 1 year later on the next Stateside. Stateside is today at 3. Michigan Radio is creating new ways to help you stay informed about your local government. You can now subscribe to podcasts of the city council meetings for more than 40 cities in Michigan. It's part of our new project, Minutes. Go to michiganradio.org and click on Minutes. In the Michigan Radio weather forecast, this afternoon, lots of sunshine, highs in the mid to upper 40s. Tonight, clear skies, lows in the 20s. Tomorrow, sunny, highs in the mid to upper 50s. Sunday, another sunny day with highs around 60. It's 1:33.
Funding for Here and Now comes from the listeners of WBUR Boston and from Indeed, with tools like skills tests designed to help quality candidates show hiring managers what they can do. Learn more at Indeed.com/credit. And the Museum of Science in Boston, providing pre-K through grade 12 engineering curricula from We Engineer to Engineering the Future, with teacher guides, storybooks, kits, and videos, all designed to fuel dynamic STEM education. More at mos.org.
This is Here and Now. The Biden administration is canceling $1 billion worth of student loans. The cancellation covers 72,000 borrowers who previously had their loans partly forgiven. Now all the debt is gone. Mike Regan is senior editor for Bloomberg News. Hi, Mike.
Hi, Peter.
Well, we should say that this news covers a relatively small group of borrowers, people who went to a school that either closed suddenly or somehow defrauded their students. What do we need to know about it?
Well, if you remember back a few years, there were some scandals involving for-profit higher education companies such as Corinthian Colleges and ITT Technical Institute. Both of them have actually closed since then amid a lot of fraud allegations. So what this does is it basically relieves any borrowers who took out federal loans to attend these schools. It forgives 100% of the loans. It also allows them to get reimbursed in many cases for money that they paid back, and also requests credit bureaus to remove sort of the negative credit reports that they may have incurred by being late on these loans. And finally, Peter, it reinstates these students' eligibility to apply for new federal student aid if they needed and they were late on these loans.
Under the Trump administration, those people did have some of their debt forgiven, but not all of it. So why is Biden now stepping in with a more generous offer?
So the Secretary of Education, Miguel Cardona, had a statement out, and he said basically that the department made a close review of these claims and all the evidence, and that they determined that these borrowers really had been harmed, and they wanted to grant them a fresh start. He said they deserve a simplified and fair path to relief when they have been harmed by the misconduct of these schools. And it kind of goes back to sort of the intention of the Obama-era policy that started all of this.
So that applies to people who were defrauded by their colleges. But let's dig into what this means for everyone else. President Biden says he's willing to forgive up to $10,000 in debt per person. Progressive Democrats, though, want him to go even further. Catch us up on that debate and if it would take an act of Congress to do anything like that.
Well, that is the debate. Many progressives are hoping Biden can just issue an executive order for this. He has responded that he thinks Congress really needs to do it. And I think it kind of just gets back to the idea that Joe Biden's a little bit more to the center than the really progressive wing of the Democratic Party. And he's probably worried a little bit about pushback against this from conservatives who will start bringing up the federal deficit and the federal debt again now that it's swollen because of all the programs related to the pandemic.
Okay, to that point, 45 million Americans have student loan debt. Adds up to approximately something like $1.7 trillion. It's a lot of money.